up your Bibles to the book of James. And we will be starting in James chapter 3. As we've been going through James, we see that James is, he's first off talking to Christians. It's a very early book that was written, might have been the first New Testament book written. Matthew could have been first, then came James, or could have been James first. We don't really know. All that to say, it says here that it was to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, which means this is a Jewish church. There weren't that many Gentiles in it. The Gentiles that were in it were probably converts to Judaism. So this was before Paul had done his missionary journeys and brought the gospel to the Gentiles. He is talking to people who have a biblical worldview, not to people who have a Gentile pagan worldview, you know, as our like our postmodern age. He's talking to people who know God's Word. They grew up knowing God's Word. But just because you know something doesn't mean that you've allowed it to have its full effect in your life. And some of the things that Jesus has said on the Sermon on the Mount, James says in here, some of the other teachings that Jesus has said, James has said. So there's lots of parallels between Matthew, the book of Matthew, and the book of James. A lot of the same things that Peter says in his first epistle and in his second epistle really come are very, there's parallels here in the book of James. So we're talking about the beginnings of the Christian church, but it applies to us. Just because we're Gentile Christians doesn't mean it applies less. It applies to us more because we've got all of God's Word. They had the Old Testament, and at that point maybe they had a gospel that had been written, but they had men who would be faithful to teach God's Word and to show through the Old Testament how Jesus was Messiah. But now we've got all of Paul's writings, as well as the Revelation. I mean, we've got everything that we need, as Peter says, for life and godliness. So there is a lot that we are going to be held accountable for. Just because we know it doesn't mean it's had its full effect in our life. Doesn't mean that we've been obedient to it. Doesn't mean that that is our thought process. And so James is speaking to us as well as the early Christian church, because we can just as easily know something and not live it. And so he had said earlier, be doers of the word and not hearers only. So all of that connects to where we are in chapter 3. The last thing he's been talking about is being doers of the word, which means in the last part of the chapter 2, he is talking about taking care of our brothers and sisters in the faith. And if you know they've got some kind of need and you don't do anything about it, you know, how do you know that you even have faith? If you don't act like a Christian, where's the evidence to prove that you are one? And he had said earlier that we are a kind of first fruits. So God is displaying us to everybody. He wants to display himself and the fruit that he is producing through our lives to everybody who he puts into our lives. There's all kinds of folks, and a lot of them we don't like. But God puts them into our lives so that he can display us to them. And that doesn't make our life easy. But if we are obedient to Jesus, then more people are going to see who he really is and what he's really like. And when they see him, they're going to be changed. Well, if you grew up in a with a biblical worldview, but that biblical worldview was tweaked by wrong teaching, that means that your worldview is tweaked by the wrong thinking. And as I had said in the last couple of weeks, you know, Jesus was confronting the Pharisees. They knew God's word. They love God's word. They believe God's word. But they didn't quite understand all the prophecies of Messiah, that he had to first come as a suffering servant before he came as a victorious Savior. So they didn't quite understand that. So they couldn't see Jesus as Messiah, because he wasn't destroying their enemies. He was coming meek and mild. He was coming loving. He was coming teaching God's word. It didn't make a lot of sense to them. But they were also jealous because he was drawing people to himself. And they wanted people's attention. Well, I say that because he confronted them. Because they had very strict regulations in the laws that regard their relationship with God, but had loose interpretations and legal loopholes for the laws that dealt with them and their brothers and sisters. And I say that because this is what James has talked about in his last chapter, in chapter 2. And now in chapter 3, he takes it beyond what we do and how we live our lives to the actual words that we say, the words that come out of our mouth. So James chapter 3. My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. For in many things we offend all. If any man offendeth not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. Behold, we put bits in the horses' mouths, that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the ships, which though they be so great, and are driven by fierce winds, yet are turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so the tongue is a little member, and boasteth great things. Behold how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire in hell. For every kind of beasts, and of birds, and of serpents, and of things in the sea is tamed, and hath been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Wherewith bless we God, even the Father, and wherewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Doth a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine figs? So can no fountain yield salt water and fresh. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness and wisdom. Lord Jesus, we ask that you give us insight into these words, dear God. Lord, let us be changed by your word, and let your word have its perfect work in our life, and let it be your words coming out of our mouths and not our words coming out from the depths of the sin in our heart. Lord, we ask that you help us in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the first verse in this chapter, we understand it in context, but it stands alone, and I have to camp on it a little bit. My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. Now, in the context, he's talking about people using their mouth. And as we read, there's a lot of ways we can use our mouth. We can use our mouth to speak wisdom. We can use our mouth to bless God. But we can use our mouth to do a lot of damage. On the first verse, he says, my brothers and sisters in Christ, be not many masters. Well, this word for master is the same word for teacher. This is a person who teaches. He says, it's not good for a lot of you to want to be a teacher. Knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. Well, the second half of this verse, he says, knowing that we. James is including himself. Why? Because James is teaching. He's saying, me as a teacher, I'm a part of this group. We shall receive the greater condemnation. Well, condemnation basically is judgment. We're going to be held to a higher account. So if you want to be a grade school teacher, you're going to be condemned. If you want to teach somebody how to fix their car, you're going to be condemned. If you want to teach somebody, is it talking about secular things or is it just talking about spiritual things? Well, I think it's a pretty broad brush. He doesn't say just spiritual things, even though we are definitely in the context of James, and James is using, you know, the first person plural, including himself, saying, I'm talking about being a teacher of God's Word. We're going to be held to a greater accountability. But just say, you know how to fix your car. And you are good at it. In fact, every conversation you have with somebody, you kind of turn it towards what you really like, which is cars. And there's always somebody whose uncle, or maybe when they were younger, had some really, maybe they had a muscle car, maybe they had, you know, some really special kind of car. And they want to talk about it. They want to talk about their car. Who doesn't want to talk about their car? And, oh, I feel so bad that I don't have that car anymore. Oh, if I only had the money, I could have gotten it fixed and I could have had this classic sitting there collecting dust in my garage. Now, you've met people like that. Maybe it's motorcycles. And they always change the direction of the conversation if they can talk about motorcycles. Or whatever it is. I mean, I'm in the horticultural industry, and so, you know, I could very easily try to get people to talk about plants, because I know plants, and because I do this for a living, I would know more than they do, and I could show off of how good I know how to take care of plants, and, you know, give them all kinds of good instruction. Now, if I made mistakes, if I didn't do it good enough, if I had some misconceptions, and other people followed my directions and they killed their plants, they're going to say, hey, I did what you said and my plant died. The guy who is taking care of cars, he says, hey, I did what you said. And my engine froze up. Now I might as well just get rid of the stupid thing, even though I love my car. How could you tell me to use this special kind of oil when in fact my car wasn't supposed to have it and you said it would probably be okay? And now it's cost me. No, you're going to be held to an account if somebody does what you say and your plant dies. Maybe it's dogs. You know, you got your special dog, and your special kind of dog's got to have a special kind of dog food. And you read all the propaganda about the special kind of dog food, and you feed your dog that special kind of dog food, somebody's talking to somebody else and their dog's got a problem. Well, you got to have my special kind of dog food, and this is all the stuff I know about my special kind of dog food. And then you give this person you're talking to, gives him the special kind of dog food, and the dog doesn't live, you know, another couple of weeks and it's over. Well, no, you needed a vet to say, no, that was good for your old overweight dog, but this dog had a problem and that just ended his life early. What's going to happen? So you killed my dog? You're going to be held to a higher condemnation. You're going to be held to an account. Well, that would break your heart if your dog died. It would break your heart if all of a sudden you got to get rid of this car. It's going to make a better boat anchor than trying to get you from here to there. You'd feel terrible if your plant died. Now take that to an exponential level greater. You're going to teach God's Word. You're going to tell people how to live their lives. This isn't something that they've got that gets them from here to there. This isn't some little plant that they've cherished and they've had it for years. This isn't their pet who snuggles up with them when they go to bed at night. This is their own soul. This is their eternal salvation. This is the eternal salvation and the entire lifestyle of everybody who they're talking to. I know I'm making some silly little examples, but James says, be not many teachers. Don't you all think that you're an expert of God's word and want to do this? Knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. We're going to be held to a higher account. I don't know if you could sue the guy who gave you bad advice for taking care of your car. If you could sue the guy that gave you bad advice and your plant died. If you could sue the guy who caused your little dog to die early. But if you go to a doctor, they've got malpractice insurance for just that kind of thing. Because something went wrong and somebody's going to want to sue you. And so they got insurance to pay for that stuff. Well, there's actually, believe it or not, malpractice insurance for pastors. Can you believe that? And in the big mega churches and the big denominations, that's part of their budget. Because these big churches got lots of money and everybody knows they got lots of money, so people are going to go there and they're going to take something that the pastor says and try to misunderstand it in a way in order to sue the denomination. So they spend, that's part of the budget of the church, malpractice insurance. I did what you say, and I lost $1 million. And you told me to pay God first. They took my house. My brethren, be not many masters. Be not many of you a teacher. Don't everybody think that because you know God's word that you want to be a teacher. Knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. We're not just going to be held to a greater account by men, even though it would be terrible as a pastor if you'd get sued. But people are doing that. I mean, what is it? Radiant or something? The people were suing them because, the pastor who's not there anymore, they got rid of him, praise God. He told the lady to divorce her husband so that he could, have her instead. It's like he was doing marriage counseling and he happened to really like this gal. Now that guy better be held to a greater condemnation. Well, let me go to Matthew 23 and just read what Jesus says here. We'll just start in the first verse, Matthew 23. Then spake Jesus to the multitude and said to his disciples, saying, the scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat, and all therefore whatsoever they bid you, observe, that observe and do. But do not ye after their works, for they say and do not. So he's saying, okay, these Pharisees, they're teachers of God's word. They are teaching the law of Moses. They're teaching the Torah. Do what they say, but don't do as they do. Why? For they bid heavy burdens and grievous to be borne and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. Why? They didn't understand grace. Their relationship with God was a transaction. They didn't understand it. So people, they never knew if they could please God, and they couldn't do enough. But all their works they do for to be seen of men. They make broad their phylacteries and enlarge the borders of their garments. Now these are the thing that sits out in front of their face. It's got God's word on it. And the garments they had extra long. It wasn't just fulfilling the law. They did it to an extreme so that everybody would know, see, I'm dedicated to the Lord. See how righteous I am. See, this thing even obscures my vision so that I'm going to see God's word before I see everything else. See, I could trip over this road, but I wanna be hindered, and I'm not gonna go as fast as I could because I wanna be hindered by what Moses taught. The whole thing was a show. Verse 6, and they love the utmost rooms and the feasts and the chief seats in the synagogue. They're showing everybody how righteous they are. And they want everybody to see them in church. You know, they're going to sit where everybody's going to see them. Well, part of it is they're going to be sit to be seen, but they're going to also sit to see. Not just whoever the rabbi is who's teaching, but all the people who they want under their authority to make sure they're there. Because if they're not there, then they're going to call on them. Hey, I didn't see you there. You're supposed to be there. What, you're not? You don't care about God's word? Don't you want to go to hell or something? And people are like that. I mean, it's all, you know, they're going to keep you under their thumb. And they love the uppermost rooms at the feasts and the chief seats in the synagogues. Okay, they want everybody to see them. And they want to be seen. And greetings in the marketplace, to be called of men, Rabbi, Rabbi. So, somebody's got a problem in their life. They've got people addicted to them, and they're going to tell them how to live their life. So anytime you got a problem, oh, you got to go talk to the rabbi. And they want everybody to come and ask them these questions. They're happy to have people addicted to them. But be not ye called rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and ye are brethren. Don't let somebody call you rabbi. Don't let somebody call you teacher. Ye are brethren. Now, there's some church denominations out there, and they don't say pastor somebody. They say brother somebody. You know, that's not a bad deal. I think it's not a bad deal at all. They don't have a senior pastor. They don't have most high, holy, reverend so-and-so like they do in a Pentecostal service. No. Don't let people call you that. Don't let people call you teacher. Don't let people call you pastor. Don't let people call you rabbi. No, call you brother. Call you sister. There's only one who's your master. That's Christ. And call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your Father which is in heaven. I mean, the whole Catholic Church, every single priest is called father this and father that and mother that. And even the sister or even the brother is a term that's supposed to be higher, as though this is a holy person and close neighbor to God, and that is someone that you can talk to God through. No, you don't have anybody call you father. Neither be ye called masters, for one is your master, even Christ. No, don't have people call you Lord. Don't have people call you teacher. You only got one. That's Jesus Christ. But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant. You want to be great? You want to be a spiritual superstar? Is it by having people notice you? Is it by you looking more holy than everybody else? Is it because you've got some kind of title that everybody is instantly going to give you honor? No, you want to be great? It's time to be a slave. Time to serve everybody. And whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased. And he that shall humble himself shall be exalted. You exalt yourself? You put yourself up? That's the person who's going to get thrown down. But whoever humbles himself, that's the one that God's going to put the spotlight on. Both Peter and James chapter 5, they both say, you know, that God opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble. You know, if you're needy, if you're dependent on God, God's going to give you grace. But if you think you're all that, God's opposed to you, you become his enemy. That's how Jesus feels about it. And James is just basically echoing what Jesus said. Be not many masters. Why? You're setting yourself up to be in opposition to God. You're setting yourself up to have people be drawn to you. It says, no, people are supposed to be drawn to Jesus the Messiah. In verse 14, well, I'll just continue on verse 13. But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for ye neither go in yourselves, neither suffer ye them that are entered to go in. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make a long prayer. Therefore ye shall receive the greater damnation. You're gonna take something from somebody who can't support themselves. Because somehow you didn't help support them and take care of them. No, you lent them some money. Why did you lend them money? So that you knew they couldn't pay, and you take their stuff. And for a pretense, you're standing up in front of the synagogue and you're giving a big, long, beautiful, righteous prayer. And people are going to think you're holy. And people are going to think you're righteous in what you do. And you just kicked the lady out on the street. It says, ye shall receive the greater damnation. Well, James says, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. We are going to be held to an account for the words that come out of our mouth. Do you want to be a teacher? Now, there is a lot of Christianity out there right now, and it's convincing people to take charge and to become, I wouldn't say professional, but definitely become like mentors, and to have an influence, and to strive to have a greater influence. Which means they're telling people to disciple, so to speak, but that's not what the thing is. It's a teaching that's getting people to try to get their fingers into everybody's lives, to tell them how to live their lives. And there's a lot of women who are getting stuck in this stuff. And they think, and they're convinced, and some demonic voice in their head that has proclaimed themselves to be Jesus has told them that this is his charge for them, that they are to, you know, exhort and to encourage and to pour into these lives of all these people. They're going to be held to a greater condemnation. If they're going to give God's word, praise God. If they're going to give their own word, if they're going to give, they're going to parrot what books they've been reading, they're going to parrot the teacher they've been listening to on the radio, or whose DVDs they've been watching, or whose books they've been reading. They're going to be held to a greater account. Now, I just wanted to put the ladies in there, because James makes it, he says, my brethren. That's men and women. I think his main point is, what's happening in the church is the gospel's being spread. And he says to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, as the Jews are undergoing persecution, they're going all over the place. Well, where they're going, there may or may not even be a synagogue. Remember when Paul got to Philippi? Was there a synagogue there? No, there were some ladies at the side of the river there worshiping God. That was it. There wasn't even enough to have a synagogue. But they knew God's word, so he had a start point. He had a reference. And this woman whose name was Lydia, a seller of purple, you know, she worked at Macy's, in other words, or whatever, you know. she got saved, and she said, if you are counting me worthy, please come and stay at my house, and I'll take care of you as long as you can stay in Philippi. I'll support your ministry as long as you're here, in other words. But the gospel is spread. And he had to get in prison in order to share the gospel to the jailer. The jailer wouldn't have heard the gospel otherwise, but the jailer and his whole family got saved. Well, we think that we want to do God's word by preaching God's word and teaching God's word and encouraging God's people. But as we are using God's word, we are going to be held to a greater account. We're going to be held to an account. A mom is going to be held to a greater account than somebody who doesn't have kids, because these are the kids who God gave her, and she is going to pour God's word into them. And who gets it right? How do you learn how that little child takes on information? You don't know right away. And as a child grows up, you still don't know. And you learn how to teach them as you realize how they get good at things and how they take on information. And you learn how to do it. And that's how you get God's Word in, as you learn them. Well, you could just say, well, you know, I told you already. Well, here's a book. You can read that, and this will tell you what to do. I mean, have you met folks like that? They'll just throw something at you. See, now you know. As though they don't care. Here's what you got. There you go. My responsibility is over. That's not a teacher. No, a teacher says, I'm going to show you how this is done. I'm going to do this with you at least the first time. Maybe I'll do it with you until you feel confident to do it yourself. I mean, a book doesn't help you. If you read a book on how to ride a bicycle, would that help you ride a bicycle?
No,
it's not going to help you at all. You got to, yes, there's some basic things. Okay, you get on, you hold on to the handlebars, you turn the wheel things, and, you know, does that mean you're going to work? Well, I know I'm supposed to work. I'm just scooting along the side. No, it's a doing. And somebody's got to hold on to you with it so you learn how to do it. Do kids just get up and walk? No. You're going to hold on to them as they're figuring out one foot in front of another. There is a huge responsibility in teaching. It's not just, here's the word. Now, I know I get on a soapbox against the mega churches, but it's not discipleship. You got this big, nice, fun, happy, clappy thing, and everybody's singing along and having a great time, and they call it worship. And then they have somebody go up there, and they're going to tell you jokes and tell you stories and tell you how to live your life, and they're out of there. And they patted you on the head, and you're good for another week. Is that how Jesus discipled his? No. His disciples were with him 24 hours a day. They ate with him. They slept with him. They listened to him. They watched his reactions. They watched how he responded. They watched him pray. They watched him fast. They knew what was going on the inside of Jesus because they were with him 24 hours a day. And when he would disappear, where'd he go? He went to go pray alone, away from his disciples, to be with his Father. They knew that. That's what it means to disciple. There's a lot of false ideas in the American Christian culture. There's a lot of false ideas in Christianity. And these false ideas came in really early. When we were going through 1 John, there was wrong ideas about who Jesus Christ was. And so he was preaching against that. And this is at the close of the first century. Well, already in the beginning of the second century, there's already problems. When John writes the Apocalypse, the revelation of Jesus Christ, he's saying, I hate the Nicolaitans. Who are the Nicolaitans? Well, we don't know a lot about them, but we know it has something to do with the clergy and the laity. That's where laity. Clergy and laity. These people up here, they're closer to God, and all you down there. You got to support these people up here, because you can't talk to God unless you talk to them first. You are addicted. You are desperate for that human being, your direct representative from God, to give you what God wants you to have. If you don't deal with that person, you don't hear from God. That started right away. Right away. And here James is saying, my brethren, be not many masters. It sounds like the right thing to do. I want to share the gospel. I want to go and tell people the truth. And they're going to be set free. And they're not going to have to go to hell. They're going to know Jesus. And everybody who is a Christian is a witness. We witness our faith. That's who we are as a Christian. We are all witnesses. That means that we are going to tell people, how come I'm not going to go to hell? How come my sins are forgiven? What happened to me? We're going to tell them what we learned, which is, Jesus got punished for my sins. Jesus died on a cross. Jesus rose from the dead. And because He rose from the dead, I'm going to rise from the dead. We're going to tell people how to get to heaven. That's who we are. That's what a Christian does. Well, you start sharing your faith, and what happens? People get saved. And people know that they went from death to life because they heard what you had to say. And they love Jesus, and they love you because you put their hand in Jesus' hands, and they're going to go to heaven now. I mean, the closest... as soon as you shared your faith and somebody got saved, and they know they're going to go to heaven because you took the time to talk to them, that person loves you. There is a connection. In fact, Paul calls them his crown. When we get to heaven, there's going to be everybody who heard the gospel through us, who we had a part in their salvation. And that, all those folks, is going to be like a crown. It's the evangelist crown. And it's going to be a crown of joy and rejoicing. All these people are going to see us and go, you're the one who talked to me about Jesus. And I'm here because you took the time to talk to me. Now, those people, if they're still in your life, they're going to come to you. That's natural. You're farther ahead in the Lord than they are. You are going to end up discipling them. That's natural. You're going to tell them, you know, when I was where you're at, this is what happened to me, and this is how I struggle with God, and this is what God told me through His Word. And you give that person what you've received from God when you were there. You've got a testimony to share. This is a normal thing. But it can go to our heads. And some people who are good evangelists, and church is no longer there really for discipleship, it's just there to bring visitors so that they can hear the gospel and get saved. It's like a perpetual, you know, revival tent. And people aren't getting discipled, but people are getting saved. And these people heard the gospel, got saved from the guy up in front. And they love Him because He's the one that shared Jesus with them. And they understood. And they got saved. And it's a very heady thing. When people love you because they heard the gospel and they're going to go to heaven now, it's a huge deal. This is kind of a side effect of sharing your faith. It's very easy to say, okay, I shared my faith and people got saved, and I guess I'm going to be a pastor now. I guess I'm going to be in charge of these people now. It's very easy to take that next step. But we're going to be held accountable to a greater degree to whom much is given, much will be expected. In Ephesians 4, I just want to go there real quick. This is Paul's teaching here. In Ephesians 4, I'll start at verse 7. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Okay? Is there anyone who is just basically going to be a greater superstar than somebody else because they're better? No, unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. God's going to give grace because that's His business. And as we know from 1 Corinthians 1, you know, He chooses the foolish things, you know. Okay. Wherefore He saith, when He ascended up on high, He led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that He ascended, what is it but that He also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same that ascended up far above the heavens, that He might fill all things. Verse 11. And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and the cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, making increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Okay. God gives grace to whoever he chooses to do whatever he wants them to do. And so he gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers. That is his gift of a human being to the church, so that the body of Christ will be edified, the body of Christ will be built up. And he did that so that we wouldn't be like children. It's easy to deceive a child. I mean, I remember one time, my dad didn't want me to go play in the attic. So he said, you know, if you pull that attic hole open and you get too close, it's going to suck you in. You might not be able to get out. And I believed it. And I didn't go play in the attic hole. But my dad would go up there and figure, well, he's big, you know, and so it's not going to suck him in. And once he was up there, you know, he would take me, but he would take me by the hand and show me how to walk on it, you know, teach me so I don't break through and, you know, get tore up in there somewhere. But that was okay while he was up there because, you know, he was leading me. And he'd already gone up there first. But don't go up there because you're going to get sucked in. You can't get out. I believe that. Why? Well, he wouldn't like me. And because of that, I never went up in the attic as a kid. Now, he would know me. I would have loved it up there. I would have spent all kinds of time up there. I mean, I would go and find a cubby hole someplace in a cabinet where the pots and pans are supposed to be, and I'd be in there for a long time. I mean, you know, I would have just a good time, and they wouldn't know where I was. And, you know, I kind of liked not being known where I was. I was deceived. And once I finally figured it out, I realized I was lied to. My dad lied to me. But kids are going to believe things. They're not going to think you're going to lie to them. They trust you. I mean, they're pretty trusting to everybody. I mean, they got to get some pretty hard hits in order to be untrusting. And when you meet a little kid who's untrusting, it's like, this poor kid. I mean, how many people have lied to this kid? You know, how many bad things have already happened with them to be that young and already untrusting? But we're not going to be like children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine. Well, if you were on a lake somewhere and the wind would blow in one direction, all of a sudden it would blow in the other direction and blow in the other direction, and you're going to be tossed back and forth and you're going to capsize. But that's how the doctrines are. There'll be some new book that comes out and everybody's got to buy it. And then 2 years later, another new book. Well, so that the person who wrote the first one doesn't get outdone, he's got to have part B of the first book he wrote, or, you know, the sequel to it. I mean, usually, if there is some book that comes out and it gets to the bestseller list, and it's some book on Christianity, it's probably not right. There's probably something wrong with it, if that many people like it. I'm not saying it's always the case, but for the most part it is. And it usually spotlights one specific truth to the expense of all others, and then people are jumping in with both feet on that one specific doctrine, that one specific truth, and they're going to take it out of context and just go run headlong with it. And then the next one will come. I remember when Prayer of Jabez came out, and then everybody went nuts on it. I mean, it just, you couldn't go anywhere without hearing about Jabez, and then you got the Jabez coin. You pull out of your thing, you could just say it. It's like you got this coin now in your pocket of a Jabez coin. You could, all you got to do is pray this special prayer, and you're going to get everything you want. Wow, I always wanted everything I wanted. Now I got a secret incantation, and it's on this coin. I'm going to give them to all my friends. You know, Spurgeon wrote on the prayer of Jabez. And then some teacher of this guy who wrote that book talked about this and spotlighted it because he had read Spurgeon's sermon on Jabez. And then this guy never got it out of his mind. And finally, when he grew up and became a real pastor, he wrote a book and made millions of dollars on this thing. Now, there wasn't like a whole lot wrong, except the people took it to the extreme and jumped in with both feet. And the New Agers reinterpreted what he had to say, you know, the New Ager Christian folks, and just went crazy on it. Well, what's different than that in the shack? Or whatever new book comes out. I mean, I every year there's something else. And what is it? It's a new doctrine tossed to and fro. Why are there so many denominations? Because each one of them stayed put in the doctrine that made them distinctive from everybody else, and they stuck there. And then somebody else got some new interpretation and started their own denomination. Somebody else got some new interpretation and stuck there. And there's a new cult started every day from something that isn't even Christian. Well, what's true? You know, we could just take the Bible and read it inductively, not deductively. Just looking at it and find out what did the Bible say in context. That's how I'm going to believe it. Or you could take one specific truth and run headlong with it. James says, we shall receive the greater condemnation. The greater, going to be held to a greater accountability. Tossed to and fro and carried about by every wind of doctrine. By the sleight of men, you know, the sleight of hand. You're lying with your hands. You're doing things that people don't know. It's called deception. And the cunning craftiness by which they lie in wait to deceive. Lying in wait and cunning craftiness and lying. Pastors would do that? It's a sleight of hand. How can they get their hand down your pants to grab your wallet? That's what they're doing. They're pickpockets. And you're going to be more than willing to open up your wallet. I have a word of God. Somebody has $1,000 and they need to give it. You laugh. Oh, we need to have a faith prayer. We're going to pray, and you can pray along, that if God gives you $1,000, that you will give it to this ministry. And now what happens? Anything gets better in your life, and you're going to think, oh, God gave me that $1,000. Well, it's got to go there, because I wouldn't be obedient to the $1,000 God gave me. And He's picking your pockets. I was just reminded of, you know, the Oral Roberts thing, you know, the seed faith and the 100% return. He invented that. And people have believed it. And he made lots of money. Of course, now all these big business churches are now starting to file for bankruptcy. The church we used to go to owes $27 million. What? are you thinking? We're God guys, God provides. How can you be in debt $27 million? That's nothing. The Crystal Cathedral had to basically go belly up. They filed for bankruptcy. They couldn't pay their Windex bill, I guess. And the Catholic Church bought it for his son. Well, Sheila was pretty close anyway, so it didn't really matter. They lie in wait to deceive. They're trying to figure out how you will be willing to do what you naturally wouldn't do, what your common sense would tell you not to do. How many hours do people have to work in their job to come up with $27 million? How many hours a day before you're going to come up with $27 million? How many people do you need coming who are working 40 hours a week or more to pay for a bill like that? Verse 15 in Ephesians 4, but speaking the truth in love may grow up into Him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. Speaking the truth in love. I am going to love enough to say stuff that's going to hurt people's feelings. I'm going to love them enough to tell them what they don't want to hear, because those words are going to be what's going to set them free from their destructive lifestyle. The words that they're going to hear is going to set them free from the fires of hell. I'm going to tell them some bad news. You're a sinner and you're condemned to hell. You need to repent. I'm going to tell them some bad news. No, it's a sin to beat up your wife. I'm going to tell them some bad news. It's a sin to have a critical spirit. I'm going to tell them some bad news. It's a sin to lie in your taxes. I'm going to tell them some bad news. It's a sin to destroy your body with alcohol, with tobacco, with prescription drugs. It's a sin to play the lottery. I'm going to tell them some bad news, and I guarantee they're not going to want to come anymore. They're going to have their feelings hurt because something that they've delighted in, and here's somebody from the front telling them it's a sin. It's stealing. It's lying. It's pharmakia. I'm going to tell them to turn off their TV, and they're not going to like it. Because you're allowing the world system to change the way you think about things. They're not going to like it. I'm going to be held to a higher account because I'm up here talking about what God's Word says. I'm going to say that because I love. And because I love, I'm going to tell the truth. Now, if a doctor came and he's your buddy, He just wants you to be his friend, and he's just trying to be friendly. And he sees the test results, finds out why you're not feeling so good. And he knows you got cancer. But he doesn't want to hurt your feelings. He doesn't want to cause you something that's going to cause some anxiety and make you feel even worse. So he's not going to tell you. And he knows that, you know, if you got proper treatment, this stuff really is going to make you sick. And he doesn't really want you to go through that. I mean, it's really sickening to have to take this chemo stuff. Or to really drastically change your lifestyle. I mean, who wants to do that? Everybody wants to live their own life. Why should he make you feel bad by wanting to change the lifestyle the way you live? So he doesn't tell you. And you stay buds, and you die in 6 months. No, if he's really your friend, if he really loves you, what he's going to do? You got cancer, and I got to take this knife, and I'm going to have to cut into your body, and I'm going to do some vicious thing to you, and I'm going to cut the cancer out, and then I'm going to give you some drugs that are going to make you sick, and you're going to wish to be dead. It makes you feel so bad. So that we can kill all that stuff, so that it can extend your life, maybe a year, maybe 10 years, maybe 15 years. I got to give you some bad news. I'm going to tell you because I love you. Now, who's going to get the malpractice suit? The guy, the doctor who says, you got cancer and this is what we got to do to treat it. Or, hey, I just want you to like me, you know. I got lots of clients, lots of patients, and we're all buds. We go party and stuff. But who's going to get the malpractice suit? The doctor who knew he had cancer and wouldn't tell him? Or the one who says, here's the bad news, and you're not going to like me anymore because I got to tell you what I got to do to get rid of this thing? Speaking the truth in love. Everybody's going to say, thank you, doctor. I need to know that. I don't want to die. But do people say, thank you, pastor. I need you to tell me it's a bad thing to shout at my wife and to beat her up and throw her across the couch. Now, they don't like hearing stuff like that. No, they'll tell you, because she made me angry. Oh, so you have the right to hurt her then. Oh, I couldn't help it. You make me angry. No, they don't want to hear stuff like that, but that's my job. And I better be a good pastor because I'm going to be held to account to God's word that I'm teaching. I got to say the bad stuff. Be not many masters. Well, since there is connections here between Peter and James, and between James and Matthew, had to quote from Matthew, so I got a quote from 1 Peter. So 1 Peter chapter 5, starting on verse 1. Peter says, the elders which are among you I exhort, who am also an elder. Peter's saying, okay, I'm the apostle, I got to tell you guys what to do. He says, no, I'm a pastor like you guys. I'm speaking from experience. I know what it's like to be in the trenches. He's not like sitting up higher in some nice throne someplace. No, he's doing pastoral work. Who am also an elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. He knows what it's like, and he's already suffered. So they've got no excuse to listen to him. But he's also going to be a partaker of the glory. You don't get the glory without the suffering. Verse 2. Feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly. Not for filthy lucre, but of ready mind. Neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being ensamples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd shall appear, he shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. He tells us how to pastor. Take oversight, which means you have to know the state of your flocks. Know what's going on. You got to know how they're feeling. You got to know what's going on with their life. This is discipleship. How can you know if you've got, who knows who shows up, you know? You get 3,000 people every Sunday. Maybe you got 30,000 people every Sunday. And you got your thing televised. And you're in a stadium because it's so big. Because you're so popular. And you want people to have their best life now. Taking oversight thereof. They don't even know these people. Not by constraint. It's not a have to. But willingly. It's just that if you don't want to do it, don't do it. This is not a work to do if you don't want to do it. I mean, this would be a horrible job if somebody didn't want to do it. And I've met pastors who didn't want to do it. It's like, what in the world are you doing it for? Well, because their great-grandfather and the father and their, you know, it's come down and now it's come to them. And they're going to do it because that's what they're expected to do. And they know it's a good business. It's a family business, and you do what you're supposed to do. You have your three-part sermon, and, you know, if you can't come up with something, there's plenty that have been written over the years that you can just memorize it. You know, it's 22 and a half minutes. Pat them on the head. Send them off their way. You got three hymns, 22 and a half minute sermon, got a little bit of liturgy, you're good to go. Taking oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly. Not for filthy lucre. I love filthy work, lucre. What a great thing, King James. Not because you want the money. You don't do it for the money. But a lot of people are, God, they're making lots of money. I mean, you know, you start telling people you got to give your tithe, you got to pay God first. If you don't give the 10%, then God's going to, everything that they own is cursed until they redeem it with 10%. So you got to make sure they give their 10%, or they're all going to have to deal with the curse. And then what are you going to do? You're going to teach financial, you know, stewardship. And why? Because if they're doing well, then they figure out how to stop wasting money, then they can give you more money. Not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind. It means eager. Eager to do what God has called you to do. Neither is being lords over God's heritage. They're all coming to hear me. And I'm in charge. And I will intimidate them. And they will do what they say, or I will destroy them. They will fear me. You think that's funny? There is a demonic stronghold on megachurch pastors, and people are afraid of them. They're afraid they're going to offend. They're afraid that they don't have what it takes to serve them. They're afraid that they're going to get caught and they're not going to be good enough. And they think it's a fear of the Lord. But it's a demonic stronghold that you get when you get the privilege of being in charge of all these people. No, it's not being empowered by the Holy Spirit. This isn't the anointing. This is demonic. And I've seen it. Well, it's absolutely pride. But pride taken to an exponential level where it's demonically empowered. And people, you know, somehow they have this demonic ability to get everybody to want them to be their friend. You know, it's like the song, I want you to want me, I need you. No, but this is reality. And people just, they in their heart, they want that pastor to want them, to like them. It's sick. It's demonic. It doesn't come from God. Neither is being lords over God's heritage, but being in samples to the flock. What is a shepherd? A real shepherd, not the way they do it in America, where, you know, they send out the dogs or they got the tasers or whatever. Get them sheep in that flock, what's the matter with it? No, the shepherd, go to Psalm 23. Go to John 10. He goes out in that field, and what does he do? He calls his sheep by name. Why does he go out in that field? He's looking for noxious weeds. He doesn't want the sheep to get sick on anything out here that's out in the field. He's also looking around. Is this a place where it's real easy for some predator to jump out of the bushes or out around the rocks where I can't see, where they're going to get taken out? He finds that field. He goes out there and he calls the sheep by name and they follow him because they belong to him and they recognize his voice. And they won't follow a shepherd's voice they don't recognize. The leader goes out first and does. That's what it means to lead. To be a leader doesn't mean you go do that, and you go do that, and you go do that. No, the leader is leading because he's doing it first, and other people go, hey, can I help you do what God's called you to do? That's what it means to be a leader. And examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd shall appear, we shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. There's the chief shepherd, that's Jesus Christ. He is the good shepherd. And he is going to hold to an account everyone who calls himself a shepherd of his flock. Now that's you're going to be held to account. That's big. Well, I got to go back to Paul's words. Acts chapter 20. These are the ones that get you. Acts 20. Paul's on his way to basically be arrested in Jerusalem. And he's talking, he doesn't want to stop in Ephesus because it's just going to be too heartbreaking for the whole congregation. So he calls all the elders of the congregation in Ephesus to meet him in Miletus. Well, I'm going to start reading in verse 17. And from Miletus he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church. And when they were come to him, he said unto them, Ye know from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind, and with many tears and temptations, which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews. Saying, you know my example. You watched me from the time I got here. You know what my ministry's been like. Verse 20, and how I kept back nothing. I said everything that God wanted me to say. I didn't keep back anything that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house. Publicly and from house to house. That's street preaching and that's discipleship from one family to the next. Testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance towards God and faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ. He's preaching repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. And now behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save that the Holy Ghost witnessed in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. It's like, okay, the Holy Spirit's saying, you're doing it, and I want to do it. I want to be led by the Lord, and this is not going to be a cool thing. And in every place I go, there's some prophets that God's got in those cities, and they're telling me, you're going to be tied up. You're going to get bound. You're going to be thrown in prison. This is not going to be cool. Verse 24. But none of these things move me. I love that verse. I don't want to camp there, but it's like, but he's not astonished. It doesn't knock him off his chariot. He doesn't fall off his horse. He doesn't just fall down and cry. None of these things move me. That's not going to change how I feel about doing what God has called me to do. Neither count my life as dear unto myself. I don't care about my life. I'm going to do what God calls me to do. If this is the end of my life, it's the end of my life. So that I might finish my course with joy. There is a specific curriculum that Jesus Christ has for Paul, and he wants to follow it to the letter to the end. And the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of grace of God. I'm going to minister the grace of God. I'm going to preach the gospel. That's what I got to do. Wherever God sends me, on my way, my mouth is going to be open to tell people about Jesus dying on the cross to save them from their sins. Verse 25, and now behold, I know that ye all, among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God, shall see my face no more. This is the last time I'll ever see you guys again, till eternity. Wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Now, this is a weird statement. He's pure from the blood of all men? What does that mean? Well, I got to do another reference from this reference. So we're going to go to Ezekiel chapter 3. I just want to be really clear that we understand what it means that he is free from the blood of all men. It's talking about Ezekiel, the call that Ezekiel had, the call to be a watchman. Okay, we'll start on verse 17 in the call that Ezekiel's got. Ezekiel 3:17, Son of man, I have made thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore hear the word at my mouth, and I will give them warning from me. When I say unto the wicked, Thou shalt surely die, and thou givest him not warning, nor speakest to warn the wicked from his wicked way, to save his life, the same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at thy hand. You got to stand in front of these wicked people and tell them about their wickedness and the judgments that's coming to them. And if you don't do it, I'm going to... And they're going to think that they don't have any guilt. They're going to think that they're not responsible. They're going to... He's saying, I'm going to hold their guilt against you. I'm going to hold their blood against you. I will require it at thy hand. Yet if thou warn the wicked, and he turn not from his wickedness, nor from his wicked ways, he shall die in his iniquity. But thou hast delivered thy soul. Okay, your soul will be free from their blood if they don't repent. If they hear it and they don't repent. Again, when a righteous man doth turn from his righteousness and commit iniquity, and I lay a stumbling block before him, and he shall die, because thou hast not given him warning, he shall die in his sins, and his righteousness, which he hath done, shall not be remembered, but his blood will I require at thy hand. So you're going to talk to the people who are wicked, and you're going to talk to the righteous who have backslid. And if the righteous who have backslid don't come back, I'm going to require, and you don't talk to them, I'm going to require it again. Nevertheless, if thou warn the righteous man, and the righteous sin not, and he doth not sin, he shall surely live because he is warned. Also thou hast delivered thy soul. Now, what kind of responsibility is that? That's huge. Paul's saying, I am not guilty of the blood of any man in Acts 20. Which means he said what he needed to say to the righteous who were playing around with sin and to the wicked who were wicked. If they liked what he had to say or not, he had to say it, and he said it. Wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. All of it. All of it. I mean, some of these mega churches, if you've been there for a while and you open up your Bible, you come to find out that it's only the same 7 books of the Bible that this pastor's ever preached from. And you can see the same notes after 4 years that you just, that, and they're still in your same Bible. It's just, you know, you can go from page to page, from cover to cover, and it works just fine. On Sunday nights, we're doing that, and we're in the Psalms. We've only got halfway so far. In the New Testament, we're going really in-depth, and we're just doing one book at a time. We haven't gotten that many yet, but we're doing the ones that I didn't hear much on. So, verse 28. Now he's going to talk about how to be a pastor. Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves, and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers. So you take care of your own life, your own walk with the Lord, and then you are overseers of all those that the Holy Ghost has given you to take care of. To feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. How does God feel about his church? Purchase them with his own blood. What is the value that is placed on us? Well, if you melt us down to our individual kind of metals, maybe we could be reconstituted and come up with maybe $67.37 for the amount of whatever it is that's in our body. Is that what we're worth? Are we worth how smart we are? Are we worth how much money we make and how much money we can give to the church? Are we worth how many of our hours we can dedicate to taking care of all the church's programs? What are we worth? Are we just a pew potato not doing anything? None of those things is the way Paul tells us, the way Jesus sees us. Our value was placed, and the value that was placed on us was the blood of Jesus Christ. The blood of God. Paul tells us, by the way, that Jesus is God. And that it was God's blood that purchased us. Right here in this verse. That's what our value is. It's not in what we could do. It's not in what we could give. It's not in who we are. Our value is shown by God himself. That's what we're worth. What does God require of thee? Your money? Working hard, doing church's programs? No, live a life in response to the price that was paid for you. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. As soon as I'm out of there, what's going to happen? There's going to be pastors, and they are going to look just like you, but they're grievous wolves. They are predators, and they're not going to spare the flock. They're not just going to fleece the flock, they're going to eat the flock. And they're coming among you. They're going to be pastors, they're going to be elders, they're going to be overseers, and they're going to oversee what chunk is going to belong to them. And they're going to say, dibs, I want that one. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. They're going to say things that are perverse, that aren't according to the counsel of God, to draw people to them, to make people be addicted to them instead of putting their hand in the hand of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of the universe, where it's safe. No, they're going to say, no, you have to do what I say. No, you have to marry the one that I'm telling you to marry. No, you have to go here. No, you have to go to school there. No, this is a job that you should do for a living. People do that still. And they call it shepherding. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. They're going to draw people to themselves. In other words, they show up in church and all these people come to hear me. No, God purchased each one of them with His own blood. That's the value He's placed on them. And you're going to stand before God and you're going to be held accountable for each one who He shed His blood for? Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. Paul took his job seriously. I mean, he's crying. Why is he crying? Because he knows if they don't repent, they're going to go to hell. And he can look at a person and know they're not going to go to heaven. And he's saying, don't you understand? Your eternity is going to be spent away from everything good, but now you're going to get what you actually do deserve for being a rebel against our holy God. And for the people who are righteous, who are living in sin, says, don't you understand your duty before God? And he'd be doing it with tears. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of His grace, which is able to build you up. That's what builds you up. The word of His grace. He gives grace to the humble. He opposes the proud. It's the word of His grace that saves anybody. It's not your words. It's not your psychology. It's not your motivational speaking. It's not how you can influence others. No, it's the word of His grace that's able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. And He says, I have coveted no man's silver, gold, or apparel. I didn't look around and see all the people who had it well and try to buddy-buddy up with them. I didn't soft-sell the gospel so that they wouldn't stop coming so that they could support my ministry. I wouldn't say things that I know I needed to say to them so that they would still like me. Yea, ye yourselves know that these hands have ministered unto my own necessities and to them that were with me. He worked for a living while he was supporting his ministry. He made tents. And he actually supported, he was so good that he actually supported his assistant pastors with his own job. This is what it means to be a pastor. You are there to take care of people, not to be taken care of. I have shown you all things, how that so laboring ye ought to support the weak, and to remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how He said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. More blessed to give than receive. Well, there's a lot of guys that stand up in front and say that. But they are saying, okay, yeah, it's not as big of a blessing, but I really want to receive here. We're going to receive the offering. It's like, I'm giving to Jesus. How come you guys are taking it? It is more blessed to give than to receive. He knew that. So it didn't matter how rich somebody might be and looked. He didn't think, oh, what a great thing. Oh, it would be so nice to have something. You know, I've never had a piece of clothes that looked like that. Wow, it would be so neat to have something like that. It must be really comfortable to walk around in a piece of clothes like that. Manipulating people, trying to get what they got. He didn't do that. Now he's working for a living to support even the people who are serving with him. And when he had thus spoken, he kneeled down and prayed with them all. And they all wept sore and fell on Paul's neck and kissed him, sorrowing most of all for the words that he had spake, that they should see his face no more. And they accompanied him unto the ship. So that's Paul's exhortation. This is how you do ministry. This is what it looks like. And it breaks my heart. And I have to be honest. Because this is not what we see. And this isn't what American Christianity looks like. Now, other parts of the world that we've been, we've seen this happen. Where, I mean, when we were in Honduras, I know I say that a lot, but they don't have anything. And these guys are supporting their families, and they are pastoring a church, and they're doing an outreach, and they still got to go back to, I forget the name of the town, Kamali or whatever, and they got a pastor's training college there. I mean, they're learning how to do it. And so what do they teach in pastor training college? They're getting some psychology courses? They're telling people how they can have good, strong families and how to get out of debt? No, what are they doing? They're teaching them how to teach the Word. And then they're teaching them how to sing hymns. And I bought one of those little hymnals, and it's just the words of Spanish, but it's all these great hymns. And they got to know all the melodies. And if they're gifted and they can play guitar, great. But they're going to stand there and they're going to sing, and people are going to sing the words that they sing, because most of the people they're singing, they don't read. And so their pastor training is, you know the songs, and you're going to sing those songs so that somebody can follow you, and you got God's Word, and you're going to trust the Holy Spirit. That's pastor training. You don't need some hash marks on your black robe to tell you the doctoral degrees that you've gotten, so that you can stand up there and say, see, you've got to listen to me, because I've got these PhDs. I got a problem with that. My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. I know I camped on this one verse, but I have to talk about it. Because we need to see church for what it's really supposed to be. And it's nothing glorious. It is nothing glorious. I mean, it's when we first started our church, the first thing that happened is the girlfriend of one of the guys who was happy to be at this new church that I was starting, she decided to try to commit suicide. I mean, and then we're trying to minister to her, and she doesn't want anything to do with us or the God's Word or whatever, and now she's got some other boyfriend and the same heart. I mean, it's just, from the beginning, it was a heartbreak. And I'm still trying to study God's Word and see what the Greek says, and I'm still sending out my notes to folks that we used to know from the other church. And I get this little email from some assistant pastor who says, you know, don't try to work so hard. Don't try to be so meticulous. Don't want. And so I wrote him back some scathing letter and said, we just had this lady try to commit suicide and all this, and you know, a pastor is dirty work. You got to get your hands dirty. You got to work for a living. I mean, basically, that's what I said. So, I'm doing the best I can. I don't want you to get to somehow influence me that I can just relax. No, it's hard work, and I'm going to be held accountable to God. He's going to be held accountable to God. We both are going to stand before God and answer. How have we used God's Word? Have we done it to have a nice, comfortable life? Are we doing it because every single person who gets saved as a person who was purchased by God's own blood. That's how important they are to Him. Are they that important to us? If they're that important, then You got to say the hard things because you love them. You love them with the love that Jesus has for them. So, in the context of where we are in the book of James, James is talking about using our tongue. And I didn't think I'd camp here this long, but I did. One verse. In the rest of the section, he's talking about how we're going to use our tongue. Well, we're to use our tongue to give glory to God and for our tongue to bless people. And that's what he's going to go on to say. And everything that comes out of our mouth, what is its results? And that's how the rest of this chapter ends. So, as we think about this chapter through the week, I just wanted to really say, I am to be held to an account as a pastor. I'm going to be held account to my, right now, at the end of my life, by the chief shepherd Jesus. But as a pastor, I am saying, okay, I want to be held to an account. Is what I'm saying not said in the Bible? Am I doing something to take advantage of somebody? Am I loving the best I can as Jesus loves those that he's redeemed? I'm not saying, well, don't call me pastor. You can call me pastor, you can call me brother, you can do whatever. My identity as a pastor is not like I love that title and I'm so much more special. I'm up here because God called me to do this. I'm doing what God told me to do. And when God told me to start the church, it wasn't some da-da-da-da, some big, beautiful, wonderful thing. It was like kicking the pants, telling me, basically it was, do what I told you to do. That's how I received it. It would be nice if it was some wonderful, great thing. No, it was like a kick in the pants. And it was so strong, I almost parked the delivery truck and walked home. Maybe I should have. But I continued working. I couldn't tell for sure if God wanted me to not work or not. And as I've gotten more into the Word, unless there's so many people and their needs are so great, I don't have time. I need to do what Paul did. Like, he had time to have a side job? No, he did that. God gave him a skill. And that skill was there so that he could not only support himself, but those who were also serving along with him, pouring the gospel into people. And sometimes when you pour the gospel into people, you gotta nail it in. You gotta screw it in. You gotta get it in there where it sticks. And it's dirty work sometimes. And it's unpleasant sometimes. And right now, it's great. Because the people who give me a hard time, they haven't been around for a while. I mean, it's a blessing. And it's been really a blessing lately. But it isn't always that way. And when you read Paul's life through the book of Acts, and when you read Paul's life in the book of 1 Thessalonians and 2 Corinthians and 2 Timothy, it's a heartbreak. It's nothing glorious. He had no 401k. He had no retirement. His retirement was, there's going to be a point in time that you, because you're a Roman citizen, you have the right to not be executed on a cross, but to be beheaded. That was the privilege that he got as a Roman citizen. He'll be executed by being beheaded and not having to die on a Roman cross. The other apostles, they all died on a cross, for the most part. That was his retirement. No pension. Just tension. The tension was what? Whether to be in the body means it's going to be profitable for you. But I would rather be with the Lord. To be absent from the body than to be present with the Lord. For me to live is Christ and to die is gain. That's what his life consisted of. He saw things the way they really were, as God sees them. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we ask that you put these truths in our heart, Lord. Lord, we want to do things the right way. And you put people in our lives to take care of. And Lord, we ask that you see, that we see things the right way. Not the way the world does it. Not the way the American Christian Church does it. but the right way, dear God. As a parent takes care of their kids. Kids don't work to support their parents. The parents work to support their kids. That's how Paul tells us to do it. Lord, help us take your word seriously. And Lord, Paul knew, and he proclaimed that he wasn't going to be guilty of the blood of any man. And Lord, let us also be able to have that same boast, that we will say what we need to say because of our love for a person, even at the extent of the relationship, even if that's what it means. Lord, let our love be your love for them, and not our want for companionship or our want of that person liking us because of what they can offer us. Lord, help us see things your way, dear God. Help us take your word seriously. And Lord, for those of us who you've called to take care of folks and to preach your word, Lord, help us be faithful, dear God. As Peter and Paul and James were faithful to death, Lord, let us be that faithful, dear Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.